those supervisors should use physical intervention as a last resort. As a last resort. What does that mean? When everything has been exhausted, all other options. That is, you would normally use physical intervention to protect yourself and others from danger. You will normally use physical intervention, yes, to disengage from harmful contact. And you use physical intervention to separate someone from a trigger which can lead to a cause of event. If you see two people, they are arguing with one another, and you see that this argument could lead to them boxing one another. Yes, two operatives can go in between them and separate them. Yes, one of you take ones to the other side, like you did in your conflict, conflict role, yeah? Yes. When you were demonstrating, you take one person away, the other person take the other person, talk to them calmly. All right? This is what physical intervention is meant for. Make sense? All right. Legal implication. Now, from the definition of physical intervention as the use of direct or indirect force. From the definition, use of direct or indirect force, bodily, physical, or mechanical, to limit a person's movement. There is a use of force, right? Now, where did we get that authority to use force on another person? Where do we get that from?
Common law.
One, common law, yes? We have these authorities from the Licensing Act 2003. This is the act that sets up the SIA, yes, to regulate private security industry. They are the one licensing premises, individual working in licensing premises, and also from the SIA, they are the one licensing operatives that work in the security industry. It is under this licensing act 2003 that premises also obtain their licenses to work. This licensing act 2003 makes it illegal for anyone who does not have an SIA license and is working as a security operative. It makes it unlawful for them, and they can be fined. They can be fined up to how much? £5,000, and they can be imprisoned for 6 months. The company that puts them to work can also be fined a limited amount. So the licensing amount, Act 2003, before you can be given an SIA license, you must have attended a training like this. You must be fit, yes, and competent. And the SIA too will ensure that they have checked your criminal background. So this is just one step. After this training, you are going to apply to SIA. They're going to check you out, who you are. They're going to check out your criminal background. They're going to check your addresses, your name, your identity, and everything about you. So that at the end of the day, when they eventually issue you a license, yes, the public that sees you will have confidence in dealing with you because they know you have gone through certain processes. The second authority, yes, that we have to use force also come under the common law, self-defense. This self-defense common law states that if anyone find themselves in an imminent danger, you have every right to use a reasonable and necessary force. If you find yourself in an imminent danger. However, whenever you are using this force, you must make sure that the force you are using is necessary, proportionate, and is reasonable. Section 3 Criminal Law Act 1967, in conjunction with Section 24A, Police Criminal Evidence Act 1984, it gives us the power to use reasonable force to effect an arrest of someone who is committing an indictable offense. In our previous classes, I have explained to you what is meant by an indictable offense, isn't it?
Yeah.
Indictable offense is a very serious crime that, when committed, can only be tried at the Crown Court. And these are offenses such as murder, homicide, ABH, GBH, theft, fraud, robbery, burglary, rape, and so on. So you can use a reasonable force to effect an arrest of someone committing this offense. And this is what you call the citizen's arrest. This is not limited to the security operatives alone. Breach of peace. If anyone is breaching the peace, assuming one of you gets up here, start throwing chairs all over the places. We have every right to use a reasonable force, yes, to arrest the person, either in stopping the person or arrest the person before we call in the police to come and get the person. Is that okay? Right? So these are the authorities that we have to use force. However, the force must be reasonable and necessary. Reasonable and necessary. As security operatives, we have ethical duty to work within the law without hurting customers we're hired to protect. Don't forget, our job as security operatives, we are hired to protect the premises, customers, yes, staffs. That is our major aim. That is the aim of getting you to work. They are not hiring you to start hurting every customer that comes down there. Do we get that? And I've repeated this a lot of times. Our job is more of a customer service job. A trespass is committed by a person who is improperly on someone else's property without consent. The law says that no more force is used to remove trespassers from your premises. No more force. is used than is necessary to remove trespassers from your premises. The use of force must be reasonable, must be necessary, preemptive strike, and justification. That is, whenever you use force, you must be able to justify it. Yes, the force you use must be reasonable and necessary. Yes, and before you use the force, it must be a preemptive strike. All physical interventions, techniques must be justified. So if you use a higher level technique, you must have a higher level of justification. So for you to use any techniques on anyone, you need to ensure that you can justify your actions. Justification. These are the questions that will be asked when we are talking of justification. Was there a need to use the force? At what stage did the door supervisor stop using the force? What was the size of the injured person compared to the door supervisor? Was the force applied in good faith or in a malicious way? Are you using the force as a form of revenge, payback time? Or are you using it justifiably? Was the amount of force reasonable or not? What was the extent of the injured party compared to the amount of the extent of the injuries suffered compared to the resistance given? So before you use the force, what is the amount of injury to you compared to the resistance you are giving? For instance, if you have someone hitting you with this bottle, yes, this is a plastic of water, and in return, because you want to defend yourself, because you have the right under the common law, self-defense, this is what the person hits you with, a bottle of water. You go ahead to get a bottle, real bottle, and you break that on the person's head. When the customer hits you with this, there was no blood, no injury. But you now break this in on the person's head. Blood all over the places. Is that a reasonable one? No. Is it necessary? No. Now, another question they will be asking is, were there any weapons used or threatened by the other party? So all this comes under justification. We want to ensure that when we are using physical intervention in the workplace, we do not accidentally or recklessly breach other laws. Under the Health and Safety at Work Act 1974, we as employees and as door supervisors, we have the responsibility to take care of our own health and safety. But we must also ensure that while we are doing this, we do not, by any act of our mission, yes, adversely affect the health and safety of other people. Yes, we are looking after ourselves. We are making sure we are safe. We are looking after our health, but make sure that act of yours omission by you does not adversely affect the health and safety of other people. As a dose provisor, we must follow health and safety safety policies provided by our employers and keep up to date. We must practice safe working habits and obey all safety rules. We must use protective equipment properly and be aware of emergency procedures. And we need to ensure that they are followed when necessary. Section 44 of the Employment Rights 1996. This gives us a right as employees that whenever we are under any threat of attack, we have every right to leave that place of work, and our employers will not be able to dismiss us or set up a disciplinary action against us. However, if you are in that situation, you must notify your employer. You cannot be using this as an excuse not to go to work. But if you are under threat of attack, either from your colleagues or from customers, you need to inform your employer so that they can take appropriate action. Professional implications. If you happen to be working in some sector, the health and social care sector, or the prisons, this training is not enough for you. You need additional training to be able to use force in dealing with the clients. In these sectors mentioned, the prisons and the health and social care sector, there are times you might need to use excessive force. There are times you might need to use some level of force which is not within this training. So you will need to go for extra training and additional guidance for you to be able to carry out your work or your duties effectively. Does that make sense? So if after obtaining your license, you happen to apply in any of these sectors, they must send you for additional training, because the training you are having now at this level is not enough for you.
Not enough for us to do what kind of job?
If you have to work in health and social care sector, mm-hmm. like mental health homes, mm-hmm. mental health hospitals, or prisons, you would need additional training. Whenever you have yourself using any of these techniques, any of these physical intervention techniques, and you observe any sign of difficulties, yes, with efforts with breathing, blocked airways or vomiting, passivity or reduced consciousness, being non-responsive, signs of head or spinal injuries, facial swelling, evidence of alcohol or drug overdose, yes, blueness around the lips, face or nails, which is a sign of asphyxia, subjects complaining of breathing, difficulty in breathing, high body temperature, sweating, exhaustion, confusion, disorientation, hallucination, delusion, mania, paranoia, bizarre behavior, extreme fear, and high resistance and abnormal strength. If you observe any of these are red flags. They are dangerous. What you do, you need to seek emergency services support immediately. And you need to desist. You need to cease from that technique you are using. These are medical emergencies. Remember, the longer the restraint is used for, the greater the exposure to risk and complication.